Hello everyone and good afternoon. I am Gaurav Dubey, co-founder of Logistics Insider, and I welcome all the audience and our distinguished panel members to our fifth e-meet, which is on the theme Demand Planning and Forecasting During COVID-19. I thank you all of you for taking out the time from your busy schedules for attending this virtual conference. This is indeed a very harrowing time for the industry. The coronavirus crisis has truly brought out a momentous change in our lives, businesses, industries, education, healthcare system, and even in our behavior. And yet, even in such testing times, the logistics and supply chain community has defied all odds by working relentlessly to serve the nation, even in the lockdown period. And to maintain a seamless supply chain, demand planning and forecasting holds the paramount importance. Demand planning is seen as the foundation of an efficient supply chain, and predicting the demand accurately allows companies to meet the right demand at the right point of time, and that too in a very efficient manner. So today we all will talk about adopting to new consumer behavior in this new normal, keeping up with the global supply chain trends, and on many other pertinent topics. So this is the brief of our panel discussion today. So at the end of the panel discussion, we will conduct the Q&A session. So this is for the audience. You could type in your query in the questions tab on the right-hand side of your screen. Our panel members will try to answer as many questions as possible. So without the further delay, I would like to request today's moderator, Mr. Nilesh Asati, who is Director of Consulting, Chainalytics, to take the charge and officially start the e-meet. Over to you, Mr. Asati.
Sure. Thanks, Gaurav. Thanks for the introduction and setting the context, right? First up, what I would like to do is introduce the other panel members, right? So we have a couple of them already live with us. First is Amartya Kumar Guha, is Associate Director Supply Chain at Flipkart. And we also have Mandar Sheer Savarkar, who is General Manager, Analytics and Solution Development at SS Supply Chain Solutions, right? We'll have a couple of more panel members joining us over the next 10 to 15 minutes, right? When we'll have the full quorum there. But we'll start off right away in the interest of time, right? What Gaurav talked about was really how coronavirus or the COVID situation has impacted the industry. And he rightfully said the logistics and supply chain function has really come to the fore in ensuring that the material still moves throughout the supply chain. And I mean, there has been a lot of talk about what the challenges are and how it is becoming very difficult for the industry as a whole to serve the customers. Also from a demand perspective, there is a lot more unpredictability. But keeping that aside for a minute, I would like to start on a positive note, right? Looking at where the silver lining is. We have been here now in this situation for the past 3 months. We have seen a lot of things. So I think it's time to look at the brighter side of it as well. So I'll start with you, Amartya. What do you think is a silver lining coming out of this COVID situation for consumer and retail businesses especially?
See, the silver lining, first I will say, if I talk about the month of March when this COVID happened, that point of time we were totally exhausted and we were in a very negative mode ki what will happen to the entire country and the business. But somewhere if you see the last 30-day, 40-day, the biggest goodness which came to the entire business, entire fraternity is that the demand is again rising and we are again coming back to where we were in the month of March. Maybe it will take some time. So one, our Indian market is a very optimistic market and we have a very good future where we will grow in, I think, in multifold. Now, when I say in multifold, why I am saying so? Within this crisis, one opportunity also came that we need to improve our own manufacturing base in country and we need to reduce the dependency on the other countries. If within this crisis, this theme takes a faster space, then obviously our economical growth along with the future of our Indian youth will be much progress that we have before COVID. So this is one positive front. Second is that if you see global economy and global manufacturing or retail, Indians are always more stronger from their mindset, and also they have a more tolerant towards any type of problem they face. So along with COVID, we face a lot of other environmental crises also. But if you see all the streets, all the places, all the industry, all the people across all the sectors are coming together and helping us to revive the economical activity and also survival existence within helping each other. So that is also positiveness. Third, yes, we have saw some dip in demand or dip in demand in some of the sector, but parallel to it, there are a lot of sector which has been actually blessed in this time of crisis. And we have acknowledged that though the demand is fluctuating between one particular sector, but other sectors are also reviving. So somewhere there is a balancing factor. And I see a lot of learning we have taken through this COVID situation on business continuity plan or how to survive within a crisis zone, how to control the cost, and ultimately the final aim to have a keep a strong margin, keeping our intensive factor in control manner. So there are a lot of positiveness within this COVID, be it sector, be it coming together as a human resource in Indian sector, be it lowering the dependency on the foreign countries, and also surviving in this very, very difficult situation. That is very positive, and I think when we will come back with full force.
Just to add to what you're saying, right? I mean, it has lent to, the past 3 months have been tough, but it has really matured a lot of functions within the industry, right? As you talked about business continuity plans and the ability to really service this market, right? I mean, those are obviously the positives that are coming out of it. We have got Puneet Agrawal also who has joined us now. Puneet is the CIO at CJ Darsal, the logistics service provider company, one of the leading ones in India. Welcome, Puneet. Puneet, you're on mute.
Yeah. Hello, Dinesh. Okay. Am I audible?
Yeah, now you're audible. Yeah.
Brilliant. Thank you for having me. So I'm sorry, I had just finished a meeting. I took a bit long.
Sure. We just started. I'll come back to you on a question. First, let me go to Mandar for his viewpoints. So Mandar, this is going to be more specific to demand forecasting and planning practitioners and the practice per se, right?
Right.
I mean, it has been a tough period for demand planning and forecasting, right? I mean, nobody plans and nobody forecasts for such a situation. What do you think is the good thing coming out of this over the past 3 months? What is the key positive or key thing that has come out of for this practice altogether?
Yeah. Right. Okay. Thanks. Thanks. So the way I am looking at this particular situation is that if you look at the traditional forecasting, demand forecasting process and the industry, we never depended on the data that was there in the available in the market today. So typically speaking, like the traditional processes like bottom up forecasting, top down forecasting, where the approach is to do the demand forecasting area. Now it is sure, I mean, to be very honest, the COVID is not yet over. I mean, we either companies do not know what is going to be a new normal after this COVID situation. If a logistics sector has started today, it is, what they are doing is they are just fulfilling the pipeline demand that was there on them, before the pre-COVID condition. So, the new normal, the way I'm looking at it, it is a great opportunity for the, people like me, companies like us, for the, who are data analytics enthusiasts to actually introduce the real, power of data analytics, real power of advanced analytics to, create that value for the value for the industry, especially in the demand forecasting area. The likes of AI, the likes of ML, will be the new normal.
Yeah. So probably, I'll just come in a little, right? So basically, when you say we haven't used the data, you're basically saying the companies have largely used the internal data because a lot of forecasting has been time series based, right? To say what I have been doing earlier, what the promotional lift is going to be, and so on and so forth, and just use that to keep on forecasting. But you're saying we need to go beyond that in terms of what's available outside the companies.
External factors. Because so let's take an example of the hotel industry today. Let's take an example of Maharashtra versus, let's say, state of Kerala. So hotel industry, the consumer behavior towards this hotel industry, food industry will be totally different in Maharashtra compared to what will be there in Kerala. Because Kerala, the outbreak of this corona is not that great. You know, Maharashtra has suffered a lot. If you ask people in Pune and Mumbai to go to the hotel for next 6 months, probably, you know, the hotels industry, they will have to change their models from a traditional hotel industry probably to a cloud-based kitchen, and that will significantly drive the demand. So the history, there will be some areas where the history will play a critical role. So example, again, like the industry of sanitizers. So people will try to be more health conscious going forward. People will try to take a lot of precautions. So there will be differences, and it will vary from industry to industry. But, you know, all in all, the way we look at it is the data analytics is going to be the key in the coming days. And that's how, you know, I look at this thing as a, you know, positive way.
Okay, so you see the demand forecasting and planning practice thrive in this market to say they need to do, but obviously they need to deliver better on the type of models that are being used, right?
Yes,
and not just this.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So coming back to you, Puneet, right? Since you come from the logistics industry, obviously the same question, but I mean, there have been too many challenges, right, for the logistics industry in terms of the lockdowns, the state level issues between one state and another state, the roadside assistant not being there for some time, right, the driver availability, and so on and so forth, right? But leaving all those challenges aside, what are the key silver lining or the good things that have come out of the past 3 months in your opinion?
So indeed, Nilesh, this has been the toughest time that the logistics providers, most of them who are operating today, must have faced in their lifetimes. So there's been so much of confusion, so much of uncertainty. Ultimately, the drivers has been the biggest challenge, as you mentioned. People have, there's been so much of panic and confusion on the ground because of conflicting instructions, fast changing advisory from the government about the restrictions on movements, and in spite of our industry being classified as essential, there has been so much difficulty that the drivers have faced in moving from one location to another. There have been almost 4,000 shipments which were stranded on ground, which we had to track on a daily or rather hourly basis to help them move. So I think the worst in that sense is behind us. Now the country started opening up and unlocking. So the silver linings, if you talk about the biggest thing that I have noticed in this period, is the uptick or the receptiveness for the team in terms of digitalization. So ours has been, logistics has been a traditional industry, so to say, and there have been a lot of reluctance in people in adopting technology as their core way of working. People prefer working on paper documents, face-to-face meetings, which was not possible these days. So, and as they say, necessity is the mother of invention.
Yeah.
So whatever IT initiative that we have taken in our company, whereby enabling our field forces, digitalizing our order booking processes, vehicle placement processes, which had met with lots of resistance. So we have been very successful in driving adoption of the same. And we have been doing an initiative where we were shifting most of our back office, most of our processes to our centralized shared services center in our head office in Hisar. So that again has been what we would have achieved in 2 years. We have been able to achieve that in 2 months. We are now moving towards very, very lean branches so that we can be more agile to respond to our customers and to handle them better. So this coupled with technology in terms of control towers, live control towers, central help desk for our fleet partners, they've been very, very instrumental. So that's on the digitalization front. And another thing is agility is the need of the hour, because of such sudden spikes in demand and, I mean, slowdowns. So we as a company have been operating a very asset light model where 90% of the business that we execute is through vehicles that we hire from the market. We move almost 2,000 truckloads every day. So our business model has been very well appreciated by the customers. Customers all of a sudden, because the domestic demand was not there, they started doing export movements. So we were there for them to mobilize enough number of vehicles. So that agility is now top of agenda for customers, and where our business model has been well established.
Yeah.
And third thing I would just mention here is there is more receptiveness for collaboration between the LSPs. So we're part of many industry associations where the times are so tough for people to cope with them. People who were arch rivals, they are now at least on a talking table that what can we do together? How can we pool in our resources? That's something which I believe is a very positive trend that has come out from this crisis.
Great, great. Yeah, I think the key thing that you talked about is necessity is the mother of invention there, right? I mean, from a technology perspective, because that's happening across nearly all the industries. And not only logistics and supply chain, but every other facet of life where people are turning to technology more and more. And which brings me to the next question, right? Given what has happened, given the technology adoption done by stuff, and Amartya, this is for you. What are some of the consumer behaviors you think will persist, right, and become the new way of consumer purchasing behavior? And this is across the retail and consumer businesses, right? Be it the fact that there is more online shopping happening because people think that it is more safer because they don't have to venture out. It comes there and it creates a behavior which can persist. It can also be the fact that instead of the big box retailers, right, which were a little further away, people are going more towards the groceries today because they are shorter distances, less crowded than maybe a big box retailer in a shopping mall might be. There are some of these things. Which ones do you think will persist and will have an impact going forward? Your audio is not coming through, I think. I can't hear you.
Yeah, sorry. It was muted. So can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, see, if I divide the time zone into 2 years, okay, and if I say short term is between 3 to 6 months, and post 6 months, I will take it midterm, and post 12 months, I will say the long term. So for the long term, I don't see there will be any change in the consumer behavior. It will be actually coming back to the same. See, retail is also a place where consumer, the retail chains, stores, the life stores, that is also a part of their life, right? They enjoy going to a store and purchase goods. So somewhere now, the COVID situation will have a short-term impact on the behavior front, on the purchase behavior, because people are afraid and they are protecting their cash as much as possible. They will be purchasing only the things which are very necessary in life. The inclination toward food is going a bit higher because they also have a threat key if there is a lockdown, if I don't get any groceries. So they're stocking it up. It is not the consumption has increased. If I extend my supply chain till the household, then I will say the end pipeline has been stuck and they are actually putting their more money to preserve those things in house. But have the eating habits have changed? No, the eating habits have not changed. The people are eating as much as they were eating before COVID. So the upstream of supply chain will have a demand. But if I say the downstream of supply chain of grocery, the demand will be actually same after some point of time. Yes, but people will be going less to the market. So there are particular sector like restaurant or maybe airline travel, they will have an impact for a short term. But after 6 months or maybe 12 months, all the things will back into normal because those things has been evolved within the society because as a consumer, we enjoy or there was a necessity and hence they are there. So maybe you can talk about mall or travel destination. So everything will be same. Now, what will have an incremental demand which will be there for a long term? I think insurance sector, medical, all those sectors will have a impact which people will be now more conscious and putting money to protect their life, and they are also scared after such type of event. None of us has actually projected we can be at home for 2 or 3 months. So those things will come up. There will be increase in demand. Coming to the within retail, online and offline channels, yes, online will have a surge in demand because most of those people are worried and they are not going out. But slowly after 6-8 months, even if I say even the COVID is there, people will be knowing how to combat and how to go out and how to live within COVID situation also. So I don't think in the long term there will be much change in demand pattern. There are certain sectors which have been impacted. But if we get a solution for COVID after 12 months, I think everything will be fine and normal, and the spending power of people will come back to normal.
Sure. So I mean, one of the things that people keep talking about, right? I mean, this is just what I keep reading and talking to people, is the fact that there has been an increased, it has been on the grocery side and the food item side, right? Where people who never used to order online have started doing that, right? Mm. And it is always the first hurdle, which is the biggest thing in these shopping behaviors, right? Where you do it. And the thing is that what would have happened over the next 6 to 12 months has happened over the next 2 to 3 months in terms of conversion of those people into their shopping behavior. And I think that's going to persist, because once you get used to it, you figure out that, yeah, this is something that I can do and save correct time, effort. Right?
Correct. See, there was always a natural growth of e-commerce for last 3-4 years also. If you see, the run rate is more than 28%, okay, or 30%. And there is a lot of investment also across from world as an Indian buyer. So there was a trend where people were actually learning to order online and enjoy online shopping. Now, yes, this COVID has given a bigger hand where they can actually, the people who are not actually online, they were more dependent on the stores. They have also tried the online system, and this consumer will be shifting to online. But I don't feel that percentage will be very too high.
Okay.
As soon as the stores will come down, if you go around 500 meter across your where you live also, you see a lot of Kirana shops, a lot of small grocery shops where people used to avoid, though they are also developing and they are also selling goods. So maybe the vicinity of shopping will not go to 5 kilometers to a big grocery shop, but people will start, the buying behavior will be shifting towards online some portion. But most of the part which retail has actually lost to online or the nearby, that will go back to them definitely. Yes, there will be certain areas in India and certain places where the consolidation will happen. The unnecessary excess retail shops, I think that will have overall optimization in a number of store. Every brand, all the brands, if I talk about clothing, if I talk about QSR, every brand will be actually thinking to optimize the number of stores they have put in India. Because of operating cost, I know many brand operates with at 10-15% stores who are non-profitable. So they will shut down the store and they will be focusing on the area where they can generate more demand. And also there will be a lot of good brand who have not focused on online shopping, who are into a retail. They will be thinking of the omni-channel type of marketing rather only a retail market. And that shift has already started in 2015-16 in South Asian countries. Okay. India was actually lacking. So this will happen. But overall, retail, see, what is the composition of retail and e-commerce today? Today, still retail is the dominant factor in India. And online, if I think about online to make it to that structure, it requires at least 4 to 5 years to fulfill those type of demand what retail service today. So if you think there will be a drastic demand change from online to retail, retail to online, I don't think none of the countries even prepared to service those type of demand. So there will be a life, and people will start going to stores. Yeah.
Okay. Got it. Thanks, Amartya, for the detailed insight. Mandar, the question I have for you, right? I think we talked about the fact that the time series forecasting versus the external data piece, right? How does one prepare for the future now, right? I mean, there has been a disruption, as we just heard from Amartya, that we are getting back to the demand piece, the economy, I mean, the people are resilient, we will come back to it. But there will not be a quick change to the external factors coming into the demand forecasting piece, right? I mean, a lot of organizations still have internal data, internal way of looking at things. So what are the things that they need to do to make sure that they are getting it at least generally right and not completely wrong, right? In terms of what the demand is going to be.
Right. I think if you ask me, it will vary from industry to industry. So if you take an example of, let's say, the groceries and other stuff, they probably will not see any change much in the demand, because, you know, what will change for them is the probably the channel. Today, if they are selling it through, let's say, DMarts of the world, tomorrow they will sell it through the big baskets of the world. But overall, for them, the demand will not be that change. But there will be some permanent changes which we can expect. So example, because of the health consciousness, growing health consciousness of the people might want to go for a, you know, example, the Dettol's, you know, hand washes of the world. I mean, you know, looking at the frequency of the people who will be start washing the hands in coming days, that might become an habit for them after 6 months as well. So hand sanitizers, the soaps, you know, these kind of stuff, which where we might see a big change that will be coming in the coming days, and that will be a big spike in the demand. So to start with, I think what I feel is the industries will have to reach to the consumer as much as possible. The granularity of the data, I mean, the one is the process, and second is how to collect this data is going to be the key. One more aspect I think organizations will have to focus on is the information flow, because traditionally, you know, most of the Indian organizations, they believe on the bottom-up forecasting approach or the top-down forecasting approach. There are very few, I would say, if you ask me percentage-wise, 65 to 70% of the organization are still doing the bottom-up forecasting approach. They're not touching the, you know, the data analytics piece of it. And if they are using, then they are using the basic, you know, time series models and probably an exponential smoothing level. But, you know, beyond that, people are not using the models today. So information flow is going to be critical, because if you go wrong on those information flows, if you still go for those hunch-based forecasting, that will create a lot of problems in the demand forecasting. So long story short, if they want to be, you know, at least if they want to be very near to the actual consumption that is going to happen, they will have to you know, keep a watch on the way the data is collected. They should use the data in proper ways in order to, you know, find out the right impacts on the consumer behaviors. And thirdly, there might be a chance people will have to visit their even demand planning processes in short term. So if they are doing the demand reviews in a monthly cycles, they might even have to increase the frequency so that they do not go off. Like one month is a big period. If they see that, you know, in the first week or 2 weeks, if the demand is not happening the way it is forecasted, they will have to correct this demand at least for the coming 15 days. And at least that will help them to be as close as possible to the actual demand, and we'll see a good improvement in the, you know, coming days. But understanding the data, using the right data sets and the information flow, I think that is going to be the critical factors, according to me, in the coming days.
Okay. Yeah. I think one of the things that is interesting is the frequency and the granularity that you talked about. And I'll come back to it from the industry, what they're views are on that, whether that has happened or is there something that is happening. Puneet, coming to you, right, what are some of the client expectations that have completely changed, right, over the past 3 months, right? And some things that you think your clients will continue to demand of you, right? Is it around visibility, tracking, whatever it is, right? I mean, because these kind of situations always create demands from the clients, and then you fulfill them, and then they become the norm, right? So what are some of these things that you think are becoming the norm now, will become the norm?
So what I've seen in this period is, one is the expectations in terms of technology and visibility, as you mentioned, like tracking of the shipments and real-time week indent placement. That's on a very, very core operations part. On a higher level, what I see the shift is in terms of the on-demand logistics. Now, people, they are not looking or not willing to commit for the dedicated resources, because things are going to be volatile, and not for a short term, maybe at least for a year or two, we can expect different sections to be locked down. So they want their partners to be more flexible in terms of their vehicle placement, which is only possible if you are operating with a very large pool of network. If you're operating through a dedicated owned assets, then your agility suffers for sure. That's one very important trend that I see. Another shift I see is the model mix in terms of like we do road primarily, but we also do rail. There have been so many situations because of the extreme lockdown during the early period. There was no vehicles available. Even local movements in the cities were very difficult. So rail movement has been, people have opened up to rail movement. So we are a significant player there. So I would expect more and more customers to increase their model, change their model mix. And the third thing that I feel is the demand planning, I believe, is a kind of lost battle only, because the volatility has been so huge. You can only do so much doing the demand planning. I believe the right intervention for the supply chain leaders in these times would be, how can they be more agile? And to become more agile, having captive distribution networks, dedicated warehouses is not going to work for long. So people are looking at, like we've been talked to very large conglomerates where they want, they are talking to us that we will give you complete our demand and traffic movements data, and you suggest what should be our transportation by rail, what should be by road. You manage our warehouses, you do develop multi-model, multi-user facilities, because it is given that LSP who's specialized into this space and who can pull in demand and loads from multiple customers would be in a much better position to offer the, to improve them asset utilization. So that is a shift which I've seen early signs. We've been like, it's been said that in India, the 3PL and outsourcing is much limited as compared to China and the US. Primarily, I believe, because of the lack of capability of the LSPs that are available in the country. So I see that accelerating quite a bit in the coming times.
Okay. I mean, as you said, I mean, if you are being asked to do on demand today, right? I mean, if that becomes successful and you're able to do it at the cost and provide the same service as you do it with the contracted ones, it obviously becomes something that will not go away, right? Because once the model is established, everybody would like to do on demand to be able to handle challenges and changes in the demand and supply scenarios. Amartya, I'll come back to you. I mean, this is related to what Mandar was talking about, right? In terms of the planning frequency and granularity, right? Has there been a shift there, right? I mean, usual planning cycles on the retail side or on the consumer businesses side has been monthly most of the times, right? Where you do a monthly planning cycle and do it. E-commerce does it a little bit more faster, right? But what's the experience and what's the recommendation from your side is to say do it faster and granular, meaning do it instead of a month long weekly one, do it for every day or a weekly bucket.
See, I will talk about food industry also. I was more with food industry in my career, and I will talk about e-commerce also. Two things are very clear. See, none of the planning cycle can come out with their structured planning what they does. We cannot change it overnight if there is a less or more demand, because there are certain structure through which the plan need to be done. Now, there are certain categories where we were 100% sure the demand is lower, and there are some steps which have been taken by all the industry. But if you see overall what has happened back in our supply chain, what will happen? There is a farm produce, agriculture produce. There are many farmers who are not growing in these 2-3 months. So in next 2-3 months, you will see there are a lot of vegetables which are out of market, and there are a lot of commodities also which we will not get. Okay. So there will, so in case you want to change also, there will be a natural trend which will actually hold you back to go with on demand. You need to stock up some of the goods for the upcoming demand or upcoming whatever event the company takes up. Second thing, the categories which are not performing today, still we need to rotate those cycles also, and hence maybe today the frequency will be changing. If I'm ordering once in a month, that might go to twice, once in 2 months or once in 3 months. But in some point of time, the category optimization will happen in all the companies. So people will try to play with less number of SKUs and have more backend inventories to produce or to keep that inventory in time of demand. So maybe on demand planning side, I can come down with the SKU number, but I will still playing with more days of inventory in my system due to the uncertainty which I can foresee in their different industry. The industry can even get shut down, right? Those type of things can also happen. But any progressive companies, what they are doing, they are trying to optimize their overall manufacturing base or overall planning cycle per month, but trying to keep a very close watch on the commodities, on the particular inventories which might have a crisis or there is a threat of getting those things from the market. So that is the overall demand which will be getting changes. But one of the important two threats which are coming on the demand planning cycle for food industry will be expiry, because as this 3 months was actually shut down, so a lot of food industry, which will include QSR, even FMCG, and maybe there will be a lot of inventories which would have been slow moving, and that will be expiring in next 2-3 months. So that is the biggest hit, and planning will be struggling to liquidate or how they can actually come out of those expiry cycles. Okay. Second thing is that working capital of many industry has been chopped off because of the planning, because there are many companies, mainly the retail, food retail sector, who works in a with no working capital. They take 30 days of inventory, they sell it in their restaurant, and then they actually pay back to the vendor. So that particular cycle has now changed, and food industries will be 100% they will be having more than 70-80 days of inventory today, and they will have a lot of expiry issues also. So the next cycle of planning will be not on the regular cycle what they used to do, running the MRPs and all. They will check each and every inventory, and they will be placing their PO basis the forecasting, because we don't have any historical data for last 3 months. We cannot take the data for doing the planning. That is also a problem with all the planner across industry. So they need to forecast with a without historical number, and they need to see what type of spike that can happen geographically also, and at the category level also. Very difficult time for the planner. But a good planner, if they have a ground connect and they can understand and they can have a forward view, they can still save and survive and also sustain the demand if they can get.
Okay, great. I think the key thing is about being grounded as a planner, right? And not just trusting what the internal data is telling you, but understanding the whole dynamics around your category of products and your channel, right?
So, Nilesh, if every company, if there is a demand and outflow also, I know there are a lot of inventories which we the companies are carrying, because might be XYZ product, which is the A category product, high moving product, they are having a regular demand. But there are C categories product also, which are slow moving product. The demand has gone 1/10. And that's where the companies are actually struggling to liquidate. This is one thing. Yeah. And second, and how they will optimize and how will they produce and what historical data, where is that data? Who will tell us that data to produce or take it?
So I think this is a good point to segue in with introduce Saurabh there, who has just joined. Hi, Saurabh. Saurabh is Director of Supply Chain India and South Asia for Kellogg's company. So Saurabh, you are the manufacturer, right? In this industry, so a completely different perspective from what we have been talking about. So I'll put a little bit of a longer question to you, right? Two things, right? One is there has been, and I mean, we ourselves have talked to companies and helped them do this, to say focus on a few SKUs as of now, right? Both to be able to manage the demand, shape the demand portion of it, as well as the capacity utilizations, the changeovers, because you have lesser capacity to be producing and so on and so forth, right? So there has been that trend that is happening over the past 2-3 months among the food manufacturing, right? Packaged foods, especially. Do you see that the learnings from that and that what you call, I would say, discipline on the portfolio piece would continue in the future, and there would be a reduction in the overall number of SKUs, and SKU portfolio optimization will become a habit, right? Yeah. Much more than what it was in the past.
So let me try and answer it saying that I've always been in favor of having a leaner portfolio, right? So across industries that I have worked, proliferation of SKUs, particularly because of marketing plans, is something that supply chains have to deal with, right? So you'll keep bringing new SKUs, you're not taking out anything out of the current portfolio, and yet your NSV does not grow as much as you expect it to. So for me, rationalization is a key exercise which should be done regularly. That's number one. Number two, in the current scenario, how do you get shelf space when the shelf space itself has come down? So half of the modern trade is currently shut down, right? Most likely in future also, while the shelves will be there, the number of shoppers that you are going to target will be much lower. And when you come to e-com, and I'm sure the e-com guys will be much more relevant here, is how do you showcase how many products are you going to advertise, right? So if you can be on the first screen, when you open your app, right, there are products which are showcased there. How many of your products are you going to be able to showcase there, right? And therefore, like you said, in a capacity constraint, in a replenishment constraint, in a transport constraint scenario, it is going to be imperative that you focus on fewer and fewer SKUs. However, that does mean that it will have an impact on innovations for the future, right? In the beginning, what we had seen when the lockdown started, people bought the larger packs. They bought the standard food products, right? And then they filled up their pantry. So that's what happened. But over a period of time, you're not going to eat the same product for 2 months, right? You will get bored of the base flavor. You'll say, I do want variety. So you'll go out and he will try out something else. Maybe he'll try a smaller pack of something else. Sooner or later, like it happens in the Western countries, and I'm talking from food point of view, you will have a variety of food which you have stored in your house, right? And you will work through it during the course of the week. And then you will again go for convenience. You will go for, like I said, variety in taste. You will go for variety of brand. In the beginning, for the last 2 months, perhaps brands did not matter. And you are just looking at availability. Whatever is available, if XYZ sauce is not available, whatever is available, I'll pick it up. But you will go back to brand loyalty soon, right? And you will go back to the brands that you trust. All that's being said and done, there exists an opportunity for up to 20% rationalization of SKUs, taking out the ones which do not sell. This is a very good opportunity to clean up the stable and bring much more sense into how supply chains are operating. I don't think it's going to go out completely and you'll say, I should only work with 50% of my portfolio. That is not going to happen for some of the reasons that I stated just now. But 15 to 20% rationalization, I think aggressively people should target. It'll help save money. That's going to be very, very important. It'll help release capacity. That's going to be very, very important. And equally from the sales and marketing standpoint point of view, they are also constrained on what advertising they can do and what the salesman on the market is going to be able to sell. It is going to help throughout to the company to ensure availability of the proper range in the market. So that would be my point of view.
I think I agree with you completely there. And just for the people who are on the call, right, and some of the early career guys, the reason we're talking about the SKU portfolio with respect to demand forecasting and planning is the more number of SKUs you have, the tougher it is to forecast and plan for it, right? I mean, the tighter you create the portfolio, the better you can plan, forecast, and do everything in your
Something, right? A lot of us or the youngsters may not know. When you forecast, if you are forecasting on a month level overall business, you are probably 95-98% accurate. As you keep going down to the product family and specific SKUs, and you reduce the horizon, you probably come to 50%. I need not even forecast. I should be tossing a coin and deciding what is it that I'm going to be selling.
I mean, most companies will meet their aggregate revenue numbers on a monthly basis, right? That forecast is never missed. That brings me to the next question, which we were discussing just now, is the planning frequency, right? So I will not only talk about the planning frequency, right? I'll put a larger question around the whole S&OP, IBP to the latest thing which is called S&OE, right? Sales and operations execution that is happening, right? And I think COVID situation was a real good test case to go ahead and look at how do you do that sales and operation execution, because it was really the need of the hour, where you are not only doing the planning, but getting the feedback from the logistics side, whether the shipments are moving or not, from the demand side, whether you are really realizing the demand or not, and then continuously refining your plans on a daily, weekly basis, right? Yeah. So how has that experience been, and what do you think is going to be in the future?
So this is something that I want to relate to a term that, I sort of coined. I don't know how accurate it would be, but it does represent the situation. And I call it SMCP. It's called single minute change of plans. Something that we talked about earlier about SMED, right? Single minute exchange of dice. And I think number one, and again, firm belief from my side, and I have taken a lot of inspiration from TOC principles. And in fact, from a particular individual, Dr. Rakesh Sinha, ex-head of supply chain for Godrej, right, who's a firm believer in this. This is about delinking demand planning or forecasting from supply planning or execution, right? So SNOP and SNOE are interlinked but separate from each other. So the first thing is demand planning. What will change is you will need to be able to run more scenarios, more what-if analysis at a higher frequency. While you can continue to say that I will do my demand planning M-2, M-3, etc., but you will have to refine your plans at a much higher frequency than you are doing. That will not happen unless you have got the software in place, right? Yeah. So I've worked with Excel. Excel and the earlier softwares will only allow you to do so much tweaking, right? You need to be able to tweak because the changes will happen at a higher frequency. Yeah. It's actually a good thing. Right. The more you get linked to a frozen demand plan way ahead into the future, we know demand plans and forecasts are always wrong. The starting point of a forecast is that it has got a forecast accuracy. It has got an error built in. Right. So the more frequently you change, the more frequently you work on it, the better you are going to get at forecasting. That's number one. The number two, coming to to replenishment or the execution. Right. I think agility and, like I said, SMCP, you can no longer afford to work, at least in FMCG industry, saying that I've got a week frozen plan, I've got a month frozen plan, and this is what you're going to get because it is linked to the forecast. Right. If the forecast is changing frequently, you should be changing at a faster pace than the forecast. So for me, execution will be driven by two things. One is how fast are your factories going to be able to respond to changeovers? Right. So which would mean that your inventory of raw material, packing material needs to be managed effectively. You can no longer depend on one single source of supply. You will have multiple suppliers there to ensure, reliability of that supply. How fast is your factory able to portfolio the entire portfolio?
Yeah.
Is it able to cycle through that thing? And the third thing is the buffers of FG and RMPM. Are you able to create central buffers which are able to run a DBMRP based of execution? Right. So that's how I think this is going to change. And it's going to be extremely important that we align our supply chains to this type of change.
Okay. Yeah. So, I mean, it boils down to the scenario-based planning capability in organization, right? So how often can you do it? How many can you do it, right? And it's not really looking from demand forecasting or planning for a single answer, but creating scenarios through that, creating scenarios on the supply side, and then really looking at how you can create flexibility in the supply chain to be able to manage any changes that happen as you go along during the month. So, it's not about the frequency and the speed. It's about the number of scenarios, the overall intelligence that you can build during your scenario planning that is more important. Right? Taking exactly from where Saurabh left, right? So how are we, as demand forecaster and planners, right, factor in this risk, right, or these scenarios while doing the statistical forecasting and demand planning exercise, right? We talked about earlier before Saurabh had joined about the fact that companies majority use internal data, their historical demands, their promotion plans, their lifts, and so on and so forth. There's an opportunity to move away beyond from that in doing forecasting. Now, when you're moving away from that, and then you also need to bring in all the scenario-based stuff and the risk-based stuff, what are the two or three things that you would leave with a demand forecaster or a planner who's listening to us to say, focus on these things, try and do these activities while you're working on them?
Right. So I think, as rightly said, I mean, Saurabh has put the right pointers, and the product portfolio reduction of the product portfolio is going to be, that is an important part he mentioned. So just to continue to that, probably, a demand planner will have to wear a hat of, they will have to understand, they will have to learn from the, from the other industry experts as well. I'll give you a very simple example of a Panwala. Now look at the Panwala. Now he doesn't have any demand planning expertise. He doesn't have any, demand forecasting statistical tool, or he doesn't have a knowledge of human statistics. But the way he plans his the finished good, he tries to do is he goes for a delayed differentiation. He tries to reduce his entire portfolio of the entire finished good to a lesser number of finished goods, so that and he reduces his lead time. So in other words, he's playing with that demand complexity concept, wherein the proliferation, SKU proliferation, the velocities are, all those 5 E's are actually used here. Now the demand planner will have to understand all these factors while doing the demand forecasting. Now, there has to be a separate revisit. So there has to be a segmentation of the products that that are there. So if you're doing a segmentation, so there will be some products which will not have much impact on the because of the COVID situation. Second, there will be a regional categorization that needs to be done. So you will have some regions which will have more impact, like Maharashtra, and probably where the COVID is more. So it requires a different attention. You cannot have a generalized, the global attention or the India level attention to be given to the to this one. So while doing the demand forecasting, probably different set of models when they are trying. So they will also have to look at the stability of the demand forecast, because sometimes what happens is when you do a statistical demand forecast, and if you are not able to provide a stable demand forecast for two months down the line, 3 months down the line, we'll have to use some advanced technologies here. We can't rely on one single method here, but we'll have to kind of ensemble our output, and we'll have to put a mix of a weighted average of probably the best performing methods, so that the output that we are getting is a mix of thing. And if one forecasting method fails, the other will take up, and you will have a better forecast accuracy in going forward. That is one of the thing I would say. Second, I think the most critical for any demand forecasting process, and especially the demand planners, is to clean the history. Because typically you cannot apply a 1 sigma, 2 sigma, 3 sigma now, because if the history has there with the COVID, and if they simply apply and bring that particular history to a normal data, that will be a wrong situation, because we are expecting that the history may have a little longer impact, because again, I'm again repeating that we are still not out, we are not out of this COVID situation. The situation may, again, there will be a second round of, there will be one more wave of COVID, probably end of June or early July, which will have more impacts on the situation of, in the world. So looking all at this point, the history cleansing again is uncritical. So we can't rely simply on that 1 sigma and 2 sigma. We'll have to use the advanced analytics, like some machine learning, some AI algorithms, to actually clean the history. And we should actually introduce the external parameters right at the basic of that history cleansing as well. So I think these are some of the things I say that the planner should look at while considering the demand forecasts now.
Yeah. So I mean, if I had to summarize it, need to be aware of the geographical differences, right, across the country. To be aware of, obviously, the category differences, and be aware that that what you have as data is now corrupted, right, because of the COVID situation, and therefore you need to think beyond just the pure data and see how you need to forecast, what you need to use, what adjustment you need to make, and what external factors you need to bring in, right? I mean,
While doing that, they should consider the general models that are available in the industry. So the example of Panwala that I gave, I mean, it's a way simplest example of a demand forecasting that is available, where he's actually using the postponement strategy on the SKU. And he's actually doing demand forecasting at an aggregate level, and then differentiating at the very last end, probably the mix and bit of strategy the planners will have to use.
It has been a great discussion so far, right? I just want to put a couple of themes out there for people who are listening in, right? So we have talked about demand forecasting planning. That is the main idea here, right? And we talked about how tough it is, what changes we need to make, what some of the models have not worked, right? from a planning perspective, Saurabh was talking about the sales and operation execution or the last minute or the plan changes every minute, right? His own acronym. How do you manage that? How do you do more scenario-based planning and all those things, right? But we have also sort of addressed some of the questions around, okay, you have done demand forecasting and planning, and we know it's very tough in this environment. So you're not going to be able to get it right? You can get it. You can do the best job that you can. But then there are fulfillment changes and fulfillment policies and fulfillment strategies that you need to use to be able to mitigate the impact of being inaccurate on demand side, right? And that's pretty important, because it is still within the planning thing. It's not so much demand planning forecasting, but it's the downstream impact of it to say, how do I manage this? And Puneet was talking about it, right? To say flexibility on the transportation side, how are they providing it, right? The on-demand portion of it, because you are not going to get it right. So how do you work with your partners? Saurabh talked about manufacturing, right? How can you be more flexible, agile on manufacturing and be able to produce and change your plans frequently, right? So just, I just wanted to put it all together, because it can get confusing to say we are not talking about demand forecasting and planning. We're talking about a lot of things. Yes, we are, because we are talking both sides of the situation, right? Not just pure technical demand forecasting and planning portion of it, right? So this is a good segue into what I next wanted to ask Amartya, right? Are there any supply chain response models to COVID that you see persist or gain momentum, right? There have been tighter supply collaborations that have been done, right? Portfolio optimization, we talked about a little bit. There is flexible resources on delivery and warehousing, right? We also saw a lot of collaboration on last mile delivery, right? Between different sectors, right? Working with each other to ensure the last mile delivery. What do you think are some things that have evolved through this thing, which is good for the industry going forward and will be adopted?
See, one thing I think Puneet has touched base in one of the questions, the collaboration part within the industry has gone up in this crisis situation. And that should play a key role in future also to make the economy, you can say, we need to reach a break-even, whatever cost we are incurring for the supply chain, that need to come back, right? Start with the primary logistics. So if you see the normal situation, all the companies are operating of their own, and there is a huge scope of backhaul where it can be optimized and there can be huge efficiency which we can get. Coming to the third-party logistics player, because most of the industry nowadays been run by third by 3PL, and we need to see what are the impact they are getting. Maybe we can offset those costs right now, saying we have an agreement, but we also need to protect the human resources who are working, who are not getting paid, and how can that is a capacity for us. So we need to see how they can survive in this situation. Coming to warehouses. Good piece is that a lot of spaces, warehouse actually has increased the demand, because somewhere the storage pass has increased in last 2-3 months because the movement is less. But overall retail industry, if you say a reality industry where we can get a better rates today, so companies should operate to get better cost in terms of new agreements than whenever you are taking a new space. Overall in country, one thing is very common, our GDP contribution is coming from 4 or 5 cities majorly, and other part of the countries is not putting effort to build a supply chain. So this situation has given a big impact that if we want to continue business or if we have a business continuity plan, then our supply chain we put up across country, that should not be only focused in this through of 4 cities. And that is not only supply chain, it's retail stores also. Most of the company are stuck because they are more majorly present in West or North, and both the part have actually been not operating, and hence the company P&L are getting hit. And same with the supply chain. If you say the warehousing also, most of the things are in this 4-5 city or nearby this city. So those things we have to also work upon, where we have a proper spread across country, and we need to see which are the emerging cities, 2-tier, 3-tier, where we can have a proper supply chain, and which will have a a good support system in times like this. Coming to the overall supply chain theme, India is not a technological driven supply chain country, any industry. Robotics, drones, and all those stuffs are, I think it will take 5-10 years to develop. Every country is actually exploring how we can use it. India supply chain base is only the human resource. So if you protect the human resource, if you build new generation people coming to supply chain, along with the expertise and experience we are having, I don't see there is much threat to supply chain, and we will be having a right type of collaboration, because on crisis people understand all the companies, it can be startup or the companies who are for a long years of time in India, they need to come together and keep the biases away and only see how we can competitive at the upstream and how we can actually collab each other and give out the best cost, best efficiency at the back end, which is supply chain. So that should be the strategy, and that will evolve slowly as well.
Okay, yeah, great. Yeah, Amartya. So I'll take one thing out of that and move to Puneet. In the interest of time, we need to move a little quickly. It's about this deepening of the supply chain infrastructure away from just the 4, 5, 10 cities or maximum some of the tier one cities. How are you seeing this playing out in the logistics sector? I mean, are you seeing the demand?
I just want to pick up one more important critical point, which I think it should known to all the people. See, India is buying fuel at the maximum cost, not in this last 2-3 months, but over historical. And if you see the global structure, the most efficient way of transporting or doing a supply chain is through ships, and it can be state to state also. And hence the countries like Japan or China or even the Europeans and USA country, they have a major share of rail or sea transportation. And they are more efficient on the cost parameter. If you see India, though we buy oil at a very high price, but maximum utilization we do with the roadway only. So we should have a big transformation on the type of transportation we are doing right now within the country or outside the country. And if there is no shift, then if you see the total spend in GDP also on the transportation is much higher than any other country, which is not very positive. It is the inefficiency actually. So that shift also we need to break slowly. Else India, if you see the ranking as a transportation within the world, is very poor. And we need to come up, and this is a time where we should introspect and see how we can collab, optimize, and also we can change the mode of transportation and even develop the sea transportation in a better way or use the rail in the more optimized.
Agree. So I'll throw the challenge over to Puneet, right? So Amartya has been talking about the transportation industry, what it needs to do, what it needs to really set up and help with the infrastructure from a rail, road, waterways, sea perspective, right? And the other piece that I was talking about is the deepening of the supply chain from just the urban markets towards the more the rural thing, because COVID has really thrown that challenge up, right? Because you couldn't move those distances as you were able to move earlier, right? And therefore, if the warehouses are located near the urban center, your tier two, tier three cities are getting starved because you are not able to move them across borders and stuff. So do you see that continuing? And then how do you see this? You talked about the fact that the rail is being more and being people are now open to using rail as a transportation mode because that's what was working. How does these two things play out in the future?
I'll touch the first point, is that is the efficiency of the logistics, where you said, what are the LSPs doing? There, I would say that there's quite a lot that LSPs need to do, but there's a lot of dependency on the shippers. In fact, when we talk about technology in such forums, I see there's such tremendous gap in terms of the intellectual conversations that we have about the sophisticated technologies and the on-ground implementation. It happens all the time that my trucks, they are reaching at the customer's warehouse and they're waiting for 3 days or 4 days for space to be made for the trucks to be unloaded. So this doesn't require any sophisticated technology for this is a very basic coordination. So so the biggest challenge I feel is there's too much that is offline which is happening. So once people have integrated view, their system to system integration between the shipper system and the LSP system and the complete chain, the vehicle and all, real-time visibility of the inventory and the space availability of the warehouses, these are kind of collaborative supply chains and connection of system that needs to be done, which I believe is not very high tech with the technology which are available today. It's just a matter of driving the change and enabling the ecosystem. And shippers have to take lead because they have the power. LSPs, they have been low on technology adoption. Few of us who have taken some lead, but the small portion is very small. The more and more shippers engage people, so it's a low-hanging fruit. I believe the truck in India that does about 250 kilometers per day, whereas it's hardly moving 25% of the time. 75% time it is waiting either for the driver resting or waiting for the goods to be loaded or unloaded or finding the next load. These are very, very low-hanging fruits. So that's where I believe industry and LSPs, they have to come together to have visibility of the bottlenecks in the system, and it's certainly a low-hanging fruit. The next point that you mentioned, you saying something?
Yeah, no, so we have a little bit of a time constraint, Puneet. Okay. So I'm sorry to move a little forward because we need to get Saurabh also an answer, and then we need to do a Q&A. I'll come back to you on the Q&A if there are some questions around the same topic. So Saurabh, I think I'll just pose the same question to you, right? I mean, going forward, we talked about demand forecasting, planning and stuff. Supply chain response, people have figured out a lot of ways in which they can be flexible, right? Given the necessity that they needed to be. What are, I would say, the top two things that you think will be adopted by the companies as a standard practice to say this is how we need to really operate?
Yeah, I think one of the key things would be that you will desegregate your stocks, right? So if you have got one warehouse across India, or you're keeping it only in one, you know, we talk about multi-echelon of inventory, right? That's going to be very, very important because you will de-risk the finished goods that you hold. Not necessarily closer to the market, but possibly in the areas where there's less chances of it getting impacted. So that's going to be very, very important. The second one, I think it has been covered. We will look to de-risk both on the input side and on the output side in terms of transportation. One would be that you cannot only depend on one mode of trucking, right? So we will need to see, can we use rails more? And I see that happening quite a bit. Much more dependable, possibly faster. Right on the supplier side, it would be about having multiple suppliers for the same product. For a long time, because of MOQ and other reasons, you know, we get stuck with only one supplier. I think that's going to change, and it has come through from personal experience. I can tell you, we are taking certain commodities from one supplier. He got locked out. Half of my products depended on that particular commodity. Yeah. So within 7 days, we got out, found another person. He got locked out. So we had to go out and find one more person. So that at least your listing of available and optional or alternate suppliers will need to be kept ready, particularly for food industry and stuff like pharma, where they need to be quality approved as well, right? Mm-hmm. These are two things I think which are going to be, it's about flexibility across. You'll have to have options.
Yeah, so basically creating resiliency measures, right, by creating options to say that do we have ability to switch from one to the other, whether it be transportation mode, warehousing, or product suppliers.
Or even people, for example, in my plants, when I did not have enough production people, my QA guys went and ran the lines, right? Yeah. Or my people from the warehouse went and started the packing machines. So flexibility in people saying that, no, this is the only job that I know or I can do. Versus saying that we have to be able to deploy from that entire pool into different areas. There are a lot of flexibility. I think that's going to be the key driving word.
Okay. So let me get into Q&A mode right now, right? Because we have another 15 minutes left. We have covered a lot of questions that have been put there in one shape or the other, but this is unique, right? I mean, what would be the impact on recruitment trends? I wouldn't direct it to any one of you. I mean, please feel free to any one of you take the chance and answer this. What should the recruitment trends and what should the graduating management students of logistic domain focus on as far as their placements are concerned, right? Any thoughts from any one of you on that?
Hello. Right. Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, Amartya.
So I will take a question. So guys, who have read in this program, listening to us, first of all, nothing has gone very wrong. Right? People are still working in the organization, and the organization has proper plan to survive in. So, at the youngster, need not worry about future. The future is pretty bright because India is a country more than 100 crore people consumption will be there. So no worries on your future. It might have some stagnation, might have some correction on money monetary part, but that is also a temporary thing. As soon as you get experience and you contribute to any industry on your work front, obviously money will come back to you. So first of all, there is no recession type of thing which is happening. Second, the biggest part of entire COVID which is coming up is that any company which is having a good supply chain, they are surviving better than any other sector. That is a very practical thing and it's becoming very quick evident to everyone. So people who are studying supply chain, they will be in more demand in the future. It is like a stock market. The shares are down for 1 or 2, 3 months. Again the things back in the normalcy. For you guys, nothing to worry in this time when you cannot go out. If you are doing an internship, there are so many materials, there are so many experts who are available now. In our childhood, we never used to get so much of freedom to reach out any person. You can get that thing.
Yeah.
So just to add to Amartya, I think this is very right. There is a temporary pause rather than a full stop, right? And more demand would be there for people who have better knowledge. And the people who are using this time to get more certifications, to get more deeper understanding of newer technologies and how the core supply chain operates are the ones who are going to have a distinct advantage in the future. And I will be looking for smarter, younger people. Okay, so let me not say younger people. Let me say people who are willing to, take risks and try out new things, because this is going to be a time of experimentation. It's going to be a time of going back to core principles. If you understand the core principles and you're ready to experiment, I think those are the people who are going to come up in the future.
Yeah.
So, and one more thing, whenever you get an opportunity, all the guys, you should not learn supply chain on the computers and laptop. Go to the field, go to the warehouse, start working. Try to prepare an LR copy and start your supply chain. If you are the graduate from IMM also, you should start from there.
Yeah.
And then so when you know the ground reality and when you have academics, that combination is a deadly combination to take you up.
Yeah. I would even go to the extent to say that this post this COVID thing, you would have a higher demand for supply chain professionals who can really do supply chain in India, right? Because I mean, we talked about it, right? I think Puneet brought it out. Mandar also brought it out, right? That there is a lot of scope for improvement in the supply chain function in India, right?
Yeah.
And this situation has really put the spotlight on those areas, right? To say, really, we don't know how to manage these things, right? We have managed it, but a lot of learning has come out with it to say we need to focus on our supply chain people, technologies, processes more and more, because they are the ones who actually drive this thing, right? Sometimes it's good to get into a focus in a wrong way, right? Where you are under the gun, because then you get all those resources to fix those things. So I see it as a positive thing for the future of supply chain profession in this country, right? Because there will be more and more focus on improving the supply chain, and there will be more and more people that will be working on it, right?
Yeah.
So it's a profession for the future, at least in India, for the next 5 to 10 years. So another question, right? I think we have 10 minutes more. This is to Saurabh and Amartya, right? The question is, how has technologies impacted in improving demand planning compared to the traditional models, right? And have you been able to successfully tweak the technologies, right, in this time to adopt the traditional demand planning models? So that is a question, but I think I'll add to it, right? And first, Saurabh, maybe you can go, right? You talked about scenario-based planning that can be done and analyze and all of that stuff, right? I mean, that's good in theory, but were you able to do it using the solutions that you already have, or was it a big challenge? And how do the companies really cope with it?
So I'll just answer in two parts. On demand planning front, we were not able to do it, right? Because we did not have the technology available and solely felt the lack of that, right? So over the last 5-6 months, we were actually planning to move ahead on this front. But we were a little, we were caught a little off guard there, and we solely felt the lack of it, right? We still carried on with our original way of doing. We only reduced the from month minus two to a month minus one. That was the only change that we could do. We were really not able to be very effective there. On the other hand, on the supply chain planning piece, we had been working on a DDMRP model for the last year and a half, and we were able to go full automation on April 3rd, right? And that has helped us immensely with a combination, like always, a human-assisted algorithms. It is not a fully automated solution. It is helping my team take better informed decisions based on actual raw data, almost on real time. And that has really helped us. So on one front, yes, we did not make much progress. On the second front, I think it the need was to also focus on replenishment rather than demand plan. And on that, I think we managed to succeed. But technology, again, like I said, AI, ML is a little bit into the future. It's going to be very, very important. But today, humans getting assisted by technology. If you don't have that, you are continuing to make wrong decisions. So it's going to be very, very important.
Okay, great. So let me move to another question.
I just want to add to the previous discussion. I think, you know, the example I would like to share is, you know, we recently implemented Saurabh was sharing about the scenario planning. We recently implemented it for one of the, you know, largest healthcare company. And as soon as the COVID situation happened in China, specifically in Wuhan, in the month of Jan, we exactly predicted them that this is going to be your customer back order by, let's say, like by April. And, you know, we were able to do that. I mean, the actual number was like 98%. We were accurate on the predicting the customer back order. So probably, you know, the data driven decision. So, you know, the people are dependent on the technology, and the technology should assist the, you know, the employees and everyone to take the informed decisions, data-driven decisions is something, you know, it's still possible. So using the different scenario planners, using the different, you know, the descriptive analytics part, I think can support a lot in these kind of situations.
So, let me come, Mandar, come back to you only for a question, and Puneet, I'll come back to you for the other question on logistics in a moment. The question is, how do we ensure that the data we're analyzing is quality data and deviation of the actual numbers isn't significant? Can digitization help improve the quality of data coming in for analysis? How do you do that?
Okay. So the way I would like to answer this, first of all, you know, we'll have to collect a lot of data on this one. So this MI and ML and AI techniques work best when you have a chunk of data available. So example, minimum, if you have 3 years of data available, let's take an example of, again, the history cleansing part. Traditionally doing a, you know, one sigma or two sigma cutting versus if you're going for a ML or AI technique for, let's say, doing the history cleansing part of it, it will really go back and look, you know, same time last quarter did it happen, same time last month did it happen, same time last year did it happen, is it a one time you know, event that has happened. So you know, it is actually using the human brain in a way. It is using the human brain to you know, extract the right information from the data itself to do the history cleansing. So this, you know, with this example, I think the cleaning and, you know, the data crunching, data conversion, data transformations will be more and more accurate if we provide the right information, right huge set of data, so that the machines themselves learn. And that's the basic of the AI and ML techniques. And I think they will help us in taking rightful decisions in coming days.
Okay, thanks. So Puneet, I think the question for you is again around two, three things, right? You talked about it, but maybe provide a little more deeper clarity into it. Is about the tracking of shipments. Is it happening now? Do we have cost-effective solutions which help, right, in the Indian industry, where you can track it throughout the GPS thing, provide full visibility to it? The other thing is on the driver shortage, right? Because I don't think that problem is already solved. That's still a continuing problem. So what are you doing there to overcome that piece?
So the tracking, as you mentioned, that so there are two operating models. One is with dedicated fleet, where it's feasible for you to have the GPS installed on the trucks, which is very much there. Most vehicles, they are large fleet operators, they have GPS. The other challenge is the on-demand fleet that you hire from the spot market, which is the fragmented small fleet operator holding. There, like mobile SIM-based, location-based services, which we have activated for our clients, that has come out very handy, which is cost-effective and gets the job done. So you only want to find out the exceptions in terms of, is the vehicle getting delayed? if there is an enormous stoppage. So if you get that information, you can act on it and at least inform the customer. So we have implemented technology. We partnered with a technology startup called Fitron, who's been doing it for us. And on the driver shortage part, that's a very, very difficult thing. The biggest drive that we have done or engaged with our customers is to improve the facilities for the drivers. The treatment that drivers get at the loading and the unloading point, that's in quite a few situations is very inhuman. So most customers, they have very stringent health safety norms. When they implement health and safety, they tend to miss on the human aspect of thing. They say the driver cannot stop once the vehicle gets in. They have been spaces where if a driver goes in for about 6 hours, they don't have a place to go to washroom. So we've been escalating those issues with the customers. So customers are becoming more aware. The larger names, they are more open to that. The smaller customers, it's important that we create common facilities in the industrial towns, those kind of things. So ultimately, unless the dignity of this profession has improved, so this won't happen. We are working with All India Transport Welfare Association, which is, they've launched a campaign called Highway Heroes. We have to improve the esteem of this profession so that the next generation, they are willing to take up this job. So quite a lot of that has been done. Government of India has been supporting us in terms of at least the messaging part, but ground level has to be done by the industry together with the LSPs.
Right. Yeah. Well, let's hope that happens, because I think it's time to do that. That is another thing that has put focus on this thing from the COVID piece, right? As to how are we managing that whole human aspect of the drivers in this country, right? Yeah. So I think we are towards the end of it. I've covered everything. So I would open it up to all of you. If you have any last comments, 30 seconds each. I would start from Saurabh.
So I think resilience of supply chains has been clearly tested during these times, and people who have got flexibility built in, those who have got people available to do different jobs, are the ones who have clearly been able to come forward. I think this is this Black Swan event is going to be a big teacher for all of us, obviously, companies are more open to investing behind technologies, automation, etc. Use this opportunity would be my advice, and try to get the best fit solution. Not the most expensive, not everything, but something which is best fit for your particular industry. And that's my key learning right now.
Puneet?
Yeah. So I would say again, such times, they are accelerator of what change and digitalization, outsourcing of logistics pooling of resources, collaboration, collaborative logistics. These are the mantras that people have come to think about, and which is going to pick up pace. So that's the key to success. Agility, what has to be strived for.
Sure. Thank you. Mandar?
Well, I see this is a very positive and a very great opportunity for each and every individual as well as the industries, because this has given a good opportunity to implement the advanced analytics into the supply chain. Use of data, use of analytics, moving towards data-driven decision is going to be the key going forward. And for us to enable to do, in order to do that, we'll have to set up the right infrastructure as well, because I think one of the questions also touched on the, when I was reading the questions, the question was around the IT infrastructure. That is again going to be the key, because if you don't have the data rightly captured, the data is not going to give you anything. It's going to be a garbage in, garbage out. So I think data-driven decisions, enabling the companies to, in order to set up these data-driven decisions, is going to be the key forward.
Sure. Thank you. Thanks, everyone. So I think the keywords coming out are resilience, digitization, agility, analytics, and data, right data, right? Getting the right data and using it effectively, right? Gaurav, I'd hand it over back to you for the end.
Yeah. Great. Thank you, sir. So as we have reached the end of today's discussion, I would like to thank you, all of you, for your time and presence and making our virtual conference a successful one. We touched the peak of close to 200 attendees today in the e-meet. I would like to extend my heartfelt gratitude to our distinguished panelists who has offered their insights and also the attendees for the thought-provoking questions. Special thanks to Mr. Nilesh Asti for conducting our conference brilliantly and with such composure. So we look forward to more such enlightening and insightful discussions ahead. So now I request our attendees to grab the virtual table and enjoy the video networking session. Thanks to everyone. Thanks to all the panel members. Yeah.
Goodbye. Thank you, Gaurav, Nilesh, Puni.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much. We've been touched.
Thank you.